Dear friends and colleagues, welcome to the Best of EASL 2016 in the topic of liver tumors that I am more than happy and honored to present this year. I am Jordi Bruix. I am the head of the BCLC here in Barcelona, indeed. And I am here together with Alejandro Forner, who is one of the faculties in the BCLC group itself. And together we will review what has happened during the meeting that has been quite focused in liver tumors and specifically in liver cancer named HCC. And we will divide this presentation in two parts. One will concentrate in the first postgraduate course that has been devoted to liver tumors. And this was a 1.5 day of knowledge and state of the art data about diagnosis, screening, treatment, and also molecular biology. And this was a very intense event because we had experts from different parts of the world, mostly Europeans, but we have also contributors from Asia and from United States. And it resulted in a nice review of all that is now the data and the evidence that should be used to screen, diagnose, and treat patients with liver cancer. One of the important parts of the postgraduate course was devoted to cholangiocarcinoma. This is a tumor that is now increasing in incidence and it's becoming a real problem, as it was the case for HCC 20 years ago. Cholangio was thought to be completely non-existing or being non-important, and now it's clear that the incidence is growing. It also affects preferentially patients with chronic liver disease, and we have to be aware of how to diagnose, how to treat, and research is ongoing in this cancer. This parallels what has been done in HCC, as I mentioned, and now we have knowledge in molecular biology, predictor, stratification in different classifications of both HCC and also cholangio, but the data need to be increased specifically in this last cancer. We also had the last part of the postgraduate devoted to tumors that are benign. These are normally not so severe and do not imply such a grim prognosis, but represent a major health work because more and more frequently the population is explored by imaging techniques. Nodules are detected within the liver frequently, and lucky enough they are benign, but they should be diagnosed, and the decisions to what to do, operate, not operate, just do follow-up, is something that was very timely to be presented, because at the same time in this EASL meeting we will have the EASL practice guidelines about benign liver tumors. And this is also a very good piece of knowledge where the data that are available now are concentrated, recommendations are given with the available evidence. In some settings the evidence is still limited, but there is a body of knowledge that is worth to be exposed, summarized, and at least frame the situation when we have to deal with patients with such a condition. And linking with this, there was a nice presentation by Sugman Rossi about the classification according to molecular profile of hepatic adenomas. This is a tumor that is benign. It is more frequently in women. And is potentially linked to the hormone therapy for anticonception or just bodybuilders. And the group of Sugman Rossi has produced in the last years lots of information about the different mutations in different genes that are relevant for the evolution of the adenoma into a lesion that can transition into a real malignant tumor or just stay as an adenoma without any grim prognosis and that should not deserve any specific medical intervention. And in the meeting, the same group, this time presented by Jean-Charles Nault, there was a presentation where more information about this classification and stratification of adenomas is presented. And in that way, is a tumor that also was kind of neglected. It's a rare tumor, but now we have far more information. And in the future years, we will see the information that is presented today appearing in the textbooks and guiding what needs to be done in conventional clinical practice. So this is, I would say, a summary of what has been the postgraduate with contribution in different aspects and clarification of some controversial topics. And now what we are going to do is kind of expose and comment the more relevant information that has been presented in abstract form or in presentations, in posters and so on, about the different steps in the field of liver cancer. And the steps are very simple. The steps are epidemiology, who is at risk, who is not at risk, what is the impact of treatment, how the screening should be implemented, how diagnosis should be done, how treatment should be selected, and how we have to follow the patients when diagnosed and treated because of this condition. So now the micro will be responsibility of Alejandro. And first of all, we should comment what is new in epidemiology and the viral evolution with the new treatments. What is new?
Okay, as clearly known, liver cancer, HCC, is one of the most frequent cancers in the world. It's considered the sixth most frequent cancer and has a really high mortality. And obviously, we need to decrease the extremely high HCC-related mortality. And we have two main strategies. The first one, and probably the main one, is to prevent the risk factors associated with the HCC development. We know that patients with liver cancer are mainly patients with chronic liver disease, and therefore, if we are able to prevent the development of chronic hepatitis, we will be able to prevent the HCC occurrence and therefore to decrease the mortality. We know that if we are able to treat the hepatitis C and hepatitis B, we will be able to decrease the mortality. We have data with the interferon-based therapies, but now that we have the new drugs that are extremely effective for hepatitis C treatment, then we want to explore if really these therapies that are able to cure the hepatitis C, if they have some kind of impact on HCC occurrence and recurrence. And we have identified a very good study from Italy, and Jordi Bruix will discuss this very interesting study that comes from Bologna. And Jordi, you want to discuss?
Yeah, this is an intriguing information that comes together with the study that we have just published online just at the very same time of the EASL meeting. And this refers to a specific niche of patients that are those that have been diagnosed with HCC on a cirrhotic liver due to HCV infection. They have received treatment for the tumor and they are in complete response, meaning that there is no active tumor recognized by the conventional criteria, and then they are treated with the new antivirals. And both in the study that is presented here from Bologna and in the study that we published, the first author is Maria Rich, what we have seen is a surprisingly high rate of tumor recurrence early after the treatment of the virus. The incidence is increased as compared to the incidence that we know is present in the different studies that we have run. I was the PI of the STORM trial comparing sorafenib versus placebo, and the rate of early recurrence there was clearly lower than the rate that we have observed in this contemporary population. And this has now been validated in the study of Bologna, and there are now in the corridors, because when you present this data, everybody comes and we share the information, and there are other groups that have been surprised by the unexpected rate of recurrence after antiviral treatment. What needs to be done now with this finding that is a concern in the optimistic setting of the antiviral therapies is to have the experience of other groups analyzed, critically reviewed, to see if our data are validated, meaning that they are consistent, or if there is any kind of geographic, ethnic variation that makes that the difference exists. We do not think that this is the case. And indeed, what we think is that the rapid cure with the rapid decline of the viral load in patients treated with the new agents results in a reduction of the inflammation. And this produces an imbalance in the relationship between inflammation and immune control. So the immune status is a mix of cytokines or all these mechanisms that are quite complicated. And this sudden decrease of the virus produces a shake, let's say, and this allows the clones that were there at the subclinical and not detected by imaging at this level And during follow-up, because of this shaking of the immune system, they emerge and they are recognized as recurrence quite close to the treatment itself. So this is something that is a concern. We have raised a warning so that other groups validate this experience, and we will see what comes in the future. But like this is something that is, a stone in the path of the success in the antivirals, in the control of the epidemic of C virus. And if confirmed, then we will have to see the balance between the success and benefits of treating C virus versus the risk in this kind of patients that have been treated for cancer. So more information is needed, but really this is something that deserves attention.
Just moving the field, once we have the chronic liver disease, the only way to prevent and to decrease the mortality associated with liver cancer is to try to diagnose the disease at a very early stage. This is done by surveillance. The only way to diagnose the disease is applying surveillance strategies. We have just only one randomized control trial performed in China. There is not a randomized control trial in Europe, but we have several cohort studies trying to demonstrate it, that surveillance is able to diagnose the disease at that earlier stage and therefore to be feasible curative therapies. And also in this meeting, we have a French study. This is a prospective cohort study involving more than 30 hospitals in France. The authors report that those patients that are cirrhotics, they are followed in a prospective way. They are able to demonstrate that those that are under a surveillance program, the authors are able to diagnose the disease at an earlier stage. They are able to offer, in much more cases, potential curative therapies, and they may offer potential curative therapies. Regarding diagnosis, there is nothing new in the meeting. And then once we have confirmed the diagnosis, the next step in the management of liver cancer is to assess the prognosis of our patients. It is very well known that the BCLC is the standard prognosis system accepted in the EASL, but obviously we need to refine this strategy. And the first thing that there are a lot of interest is to refine how we can evaluate the liver dysfunction. Liver dysfunction is critical for assessing the prognosis of patients with liver cancer. And in the BCLC, we use the Child Pugh classification, but one of the limitations of this classification is that it incorporates subjective data, for instance, the evaluation of ascites or the evaluation of encephalopathy. And 1 year ago, a multicenter study proposed a new classification that was called the ALBI grade, that was a mathematical formula that using just only bilirubin and albumin that performed a grading of the liver impairment. This study demonstrated that the ALBI grade was similar to the Child Pugh, but again, we need external validation for this ALBI grade. And in this meeting, we have identified a study from UK. In this study, the authors include a huge amount of patients and they validate the usefulness of ALBI grade in different type of patients with different tumor states. This is, we consider, a very interesting study.
May I, for those of the viewers that are young, you may not even know how the Child Pugh was developed. And this was a system that was put in place to sense the risk of death in patients that had variceal bleeding if they would be treated by portosystemic shunting. Portosystemic shunting is an operation that is not really in place today. And at that time, what was used was a statistical approach to identify the classification that now would not be really accepted as robust. It was clinically appealing. The Child's Pugh A, B, C really reflects Child's A early, Child C end stage, and in the middle you have Child's Pugh B. And Child's Pugh B is heterogeneous, everybody knows. There are advanced Child's Pugh B that deserve transplant, even if they do not reach C, and we all know that not all the patients in Child Pugh B are compensated at all, so most of them are decompensated, and the same happens in Child Pugh A. So the use of Child Pugh is conventional, but it needs to be refined. And it's obviously refined, for example, in the transplant setting, using the MELD score to predict who is going to die sooner. And when we select patients for transplant, we also take into account parameters such as bacterial peritonitis, repeated encephalopathy that may be solved. So there are other things that may be suggestive of end-stage liver disease despite a child puke A. And the same happens with MELD. Some patients are not captured. So this is important because frequently people just go through the child puke, size B, P may be heavily descompensated, and this should not be treated as a patient that would be in better condition.
Okay. Just moving, another important field in the management of liver cancer is when we have patients that are not in an early stage, they are in the intermediate and advanced stage, and there are a lot of studies trying to evaluate the prognosis of this population and basically the outcome after therapies. We clearly know that TACE is the treatment of choice in patients with intermediate stage, but when we review the literature, we are able to demonstrate that the survival obtained with TACE is very heterogeneous and depends in several aspects. And there are a lot of tools that have been proposed in the last years to evaluate the potential impact that may have TACE in those patients with intermediate stage. And there is a very, very nice study coming from the group of Vicenzo Mazzaferro, and they developed a mathematical model that included some variables, basically tumor and response and liver function variables, that are able to estimate the potential efficacy of chemoembolization in a given population. Again, this is a proposal, should be externally validated, but it's a way of approaching the patients treated with TACE, and they have performed more or less the same model that they performed in the MetroTicket analysis when they analyze the potential efficacy and the long-term outcome in those patients with an early disease treated with transplantation. Exactly the same approach, but basically using patients treated with TACE in an intermediate stage. Again, it's an appealing way of evaluating the outcome of this population, but we cannot recommend this tool until the community validate this proposal. And finally, we will move to the advanced disease. This is the most active field in the management of liver cancer. We know that sorafenib is the standard of care. There are two randomized controlled trials that have demonstrated that sorafenib has impact on survival. But now that we have a lot of data coming from the core studies, we have been able to demonstrate that the impact of sorafenib is not homogeneous. There are patients that they have a really very nice response to sorafenib, and patients that probably sorafenib has not impact. Now, we need to identify this population to select which treatment option is the best. In this field, we have several studies, and one of the studies has been published by a group of Philip Johnson, and if you want, Jordi, you can make a discussion of this meta-analysis.
Yeah, one of the controversial areas in liver cancer is to what extent the etiology of the underlying liver, C virus versus B virus versus alcohol, predicts a different outcome. And the suggested thing is that patients with a B virus infection would have a poorer prognosis. And this is based in the data coming from Asia, where the survival of patients in advanced setting treated with chemotherapy or with sorafenib now had a poorer outcome in different studies. And this was a concern that has been in place for several years. Now, since we run the sorafenib study in the West, together with the Asian Pacific trial with the same design, comparing sorafenib with placebo, what we have been able to do is to put together the two databases that were quite similar, and then check if the etiology would dictate a different outcome. And this was not the case. What we showed and found, and I recently presented this in the Asia-Pacific meeting that took place in Tokyo, what is the case is that patients in Asia were more advanced, they had more frequently symptoms, more frequently vascular invasion when they reached the trial. And when we introduced the etiology in the prognostic model, etiology does not appear as significant. What it did appear there is that all the patients, both B virus, C virus, alcoholics, benefit from treatment, but the C virus patients have a higher magnitude of benefit. So sorafenib is more, let's say, provides a better benefit in C virus patients, but also benefit in B virus. This is important in terms of trial design. If we would run sorafenib versus a different agent, we should probably stratify C virus patients and the others, because in the cohort of C virus would have a better outcome with sorafenib, and this is important in this condition. The analysis that have been done, such as the one by Philip Johnson, puts together different trials but does not control for the different tumor burden. And in that way, it may look that Asia or C virus or whatever behave different, but indeed, the only way to prove that this is present or not, a different outcome because of etiology, is to mix the two populations. And when you do that, the difference is not there. So this suggestion that Philip Johnson keeps supporting probably is very controversial. I would say that is not right.
And just only add that this is a meta-analysis including three randomized control trials. In the three trials, sorafenib was the control arm, but Philip Johnson compared the impact of sorafenib not against placebo, but he compares against different drugs. And therefore, again, the authors include another additional bias, that is that this population are treated with different alternatives, and therefore the comparisons is a bit biased, and we have to keep to take with caution this
point is relevant when we analyze outcomes and we design trials. This is the main place where this information and debate is relevant, and this is why we felt it was worth to comment the different views and the different data, because this is what is discussed every time we have to run a trial with systemic therapy, to what extent etiology should be a stratification factor.
And then moving on with the sorafenib therapy, as I have said, the population that are treated with sorafenib, the outcome is very heterogeneous, and this is clear that there are some population that may benefit from sorafenib in a very relevant way, and with this aim, a multicenter Spanish study analyzed the potential effect or the potential possibility of sorafenib to offer complete response in those patients with advanced disease. This is a multicenter study. This study includes a huge number of patients. In fact, the authors include more than 1,000 patients treated with sorafenib in Spain. The authors review all the cases that the radiologists report complete response. This complete response was validated by a central review. And at the end, 19 patients, that was basically 1% of the population, sorafenib was able to obtain complete necrosis of the lesion. And there are two important messages. The first, this population is just only 1%. The median survival was superior to 70 months, and therefore this is not just only complete necrosis by radiology, also a real impact on survival in this subset of patients. And the second most important message that is delivered by the authors is that most of these patients, near all of them except one, developed the metabolic side effects. And again, this is another proof that there are some evolutionary effects under sorafenib, basically the metabolic effects, that may help physicians to identify those patients with an excellent outcome after sorafenib. And finally, we have sorafenib as a standard of care, but we don't have other additional agents alone or in combination with sorafenib, and there is a lot of studies going on for evaluating different combinations with sorafenib or agents alone, and in this meeting we have just only a randomized control trial related to this field. That this is a study coming from Japan that Jordi will comment. It's a study coming from a multicenter study coming from the group of Kudo, and in this study was a phase 3 trial, randomized sorafenib versus sorafenib in combination with low dose of cisplatin and fluorouracil in an intraarterial infusion. If you want to comment.
Yeah, this is an option of treatment that is very popular in Asia, especially in Japan. And for years, it has been suggested in that area to be effective and potentially better even than sorafenib. Now this trial confirms that this is not the case. So the usefulness of this approach through intraarterial delivery into the liver is not longer, let's say, supported by data. And I think that this clarifies lots of discussions that have been going on for the last 10 years about this option that has never been tested in such a phase 3 trial, and now we have the data and this is relevant to clarify the field.
This is probably the most relevant studies published in this International Liver Congress, and I'm really very more than happy to share with you all our thinking and our opinions regarding the best studies. And I would like to thank Jordi for his collaboration.
More than pleased to have been here. Liver cancer evolves, the knowledge advances, and the EASL meeting is the place where things have to be presented. Thank you.